pleasure to be with you on this afternoon's presentation. As you've undoubtedly heard, we have a very special guest in the studio this afternoon. That's the alto saxophonist Lee Konitz. And Lee's brought up a very nice gift for you listeners, and that's a tape of a lot of material of his that you haven't heard before in a variety of settings with a lot of people you've undoubtedly heard of and a lot of music you'll undoubtedly want to hear. So while we get everything balanced and set up here in the studio, we're going to turn to one of Lee's latest albums. It's a duo record, Lee Konitz and Michelle Petrucciani.
No, Petrucciani.
Okay, now say it again.
Petrucciani.
Okay. And when was this recorded, Lee?
Last year in Paris.
Last year in Paris. All right. We'll go to the solo title from the album, saxophone solo called Ode, and then we'll come back and then we'll get a chance to talk and talk about what we'll be listening to for the rest of the afternoon. Now a little bit of an introduction, solo saxophone, of our guest, Mr. Lee Konitz.
Thank you.
Yes, that's called Ode, and it's from the new release. Lee, you were remarking about how recently it was recorded.
When yes, this was actually recorded May 25th, 82, now that I look at the jacket. And I must mention that this was released much sooner than records I've made generally are. Later on, there's a track from a record I did with Marcel Solal at a Berlin festival in 1980, and they just released that one also 2 years later. So I really appreciated that he did it that fast, and I'm sorry, I'd forgotten. It felt like last year, but it wasn't quite.
What label is it on? It's on the
It's on Owl, O-W-L. It's a French label. And
Is the name of the album Toot Sweet?
The name is T-O-O-T Suite, S-W-E-E-T, and the French producer didn't quite understand the double entendre. I explained it to him, and he still didn't quite know whether it would work or not, but it's on. When I got the album, there it was, Toot Sweet.
You called that particular saxophone solo Ode. Gives me a chance to ask you a question. When you do a solo piece like that, like let's take that one in particular. Are you thinking harmonically of another tune? Are you thinking of a key? Are you?
Well, I was thinking of I played that old feeling, and I had a little bit of a cold that day, so I called it Ode Feeling, and they put Ode on it.
I see. So that's where it
comes
from.
Logic to everything. You know what I mean, Loren?
Sure. Well, you're playing anyway. Solos are something that you've been doing quite a bit. At least I know. I can think of Lee Konitz saxophone solos going back maybe 20 years or so. When did you start playing solo saxophone pieces in public?
Well, actually in the last number of years, I would say, that has been kind of being encouraged and has kind of worked. The solo and the solo horn, especially the solo piano, of course, has been, or solo guitar has been self-sufficient for many years. But I think people finally were interested to hear how the single line worked, apart from all the under trimmings. And it has been being encouraged more and more in the last few years. And I made one record, a solo record, which was an afterthought. I made a record with Red Mitchell on Steeplechase a few years ago and asked the producer for an hour studio time just to do the solo thing that I do at home all the time, and wondered if anybody would be interested. It could be sold as warming up a riff or before and after or whatever. And I did 40 minutes of The Song Is You and 20 minutes of Cherokee, and he wrote me and wanted to use the 40 minutes of The Song Is You, and I suggested at least as long as I had to turn the record over to change the chord progression in the key. But it works, you know. Some guy came up to me in the club the other day and said, "You got a lot of nerve playing solo for a whole record." I said, "Well, you know, what the hell?
You don't have to buy it if you don't want to."
Yeah.
But you did a solo on that Tribute to Charlie Parker concert, which was 65.
That was the
65.
First time, right.
That was the first time.
Yeah.
What was the reasoning behind that? The rhythm section hadn't arrived?
No, the rhythm section was a good one, and they were there, and it was, you know, like everyone was going on for 4 minutes and coming off, and everybody wanted to pay their respects, and as I was standing in the wings trying to decide whether to adjust to the rhythm section for the five-minute spot I had, I decided it would be fun to try it alone, and when the guy asked me if I wanted the rhythm section, I just said no, and I went out and looked around Carnegie Hall, and it was a wild experience.
Yeah.
And I just looked up the top balcony and decided to aim the sound for the top balcony, and I got it right in there.
Yeah, and that was the Blues for Bird, which is on the Charlie Parker concert memorial album, done I think around 1965.
Yeah.
Well, gee, I've got a lot of questions I'd like to ask you about your music and your playing, but maybe we should get to some music first, and that'll spur some more thoughts on.
Well, my idea when you asked me to come on the show was to either bring my favorite records of other people, so I wouldn't be just tooting my own horn, and then I thought there were the records that I hear on your shows all the time anyway. Lester or Bird or Louis or all the great players is who I like to listen to. And then I decided I didn't really feel like tucking my albums under my arm and coming up. And I do have, with the benefits of these cassettes, little gifts from various things that I do around the world. And they're sitting on my shelf, and I thought it would be fun to try to string up an example of some few various situations that I haven't recorded with. This first one, for example, last year in July, I was in Banff, and the music section there at the end of July, and Albert Mangelsdorf was there also on the staff, and we did a concert one evening and played a couple pieces, and they kind of worked pretty nice, and they were interesting. This is another phenomenon, two single note instruments, two horns playing duets in public and having it work. It was unusual, I thought. So this first piece is a piece of Albert's that I called Hanover Square. And the second piece you'll recognize, I'm sure.
Okay. Lee Konitz and Albert Mangelsdorf, live at Banff. Thank you. Marvelous performances of Mood Indigo. And what was the name of the first tune?
Hanover Square.
Hanover Square.
We met and did a concert at the Hanover Radio last year, and that's how the title came about.
I see.
I must say that Albert hardly plays a single note conception on the trombone with his multiphonics. It felt like I was playing with a brass section frequently.
When was the first time that you played with Albert Mangelsdorf? Was this it?
Oh, no. We played together and recorded together early on, many years ago. And then for many years, we just didn't come in contact. And
see.
Then someone just in Italy asked us to play some duets in Italy last year, because they had heard that record over the years, and so we started playing a little bit together.
Where is Banff, by the way?
In Alberta, Canada, near Calgary.
It was
it's a beautiful place, and they have a great jazz department. I'm not going to be there this year, but Kenny Wheeler, the trumpeter from London, mm-hmm. and Albert and John Abercrombie and Dave Holland and Don Thompson. You know Don Thompson?
Bass player
and piano
Canada.
Player.
Yeah.
He's playing with George Shearing now.
Oh, is he with George Shearing?
Yeah.
He played with Ed Bickert, I know, for
yeah.
a while.
And it's a beautiful place, and it's just for people, and there's some scholarships available. People who are interested should check that out. It's quite a nice situation.
Yeah. What have you got for us next?
The next thing, in January of this year, I was invited to record with Art Pepper in California for a Japanese label. I have a track of that here, and I believe the station has a copy of that record. It's called Hi Jingo.
Yes, we do.
Jingo is my dog's name.
Who I met today.
I would like to dedicate this program to Jingo. And Tavia and Ruth, the Adala gang, who are driving around in the car right now listening. So while I was in California, I called Chick, who has a studio. He lives in Griffith Park, Chick Corea, and he has a beautiful building that he got and has built a great recording studio in it. And he can look around and play a little bit. So we played that afternoon, and it was really a lot of fun. And one of the songs, this next piece was one of the tunes that we did that afternoon.
I see. Here it is.
Thank you.
The anniversary song.
Waltz.
Yeah. Lee Konitz, our guest on this afternoon's Out to Lunch, and Chick Corea. Now, that title wasn't issued on the record.
No.
Okay. So none of the stuff we're hearing is issued.
Well, there will be a couple. Well, the first thing you played was...
Right.
You mean with Chick?
I mean the things on the tape, from your tape that we're playing.
There's a one thing from the Art Pepper album.
I see.
I just wanted to play and Marcel Solal album. The next one that I brought was from the Woodstock concert of, I think it was 2 years ago, a benefit for the Creative Music Studio, Carl Berger's school out there. And this was the first time that I had gotten to play a duet with Chick, and we played... two pieces that night. This is the second one. It's around about midnight. And it was cold out there.
One more time? It was cold?
It was cold, yeah. And it was raining all afternoon. The concert started about 4 hours late, so by the time we played, everybody was shivering in their britches.
Yeah. Was this the first time that you'd had the chance to play with Chick at all, or had you over the years?
Well, Chick played a couple concerts with me earlier on. I had tapes of one of them anyway, and the next show I'll bring some of that up.
Great. Lee Konitz, our very special guest on Out to Lunch, and Chick Corea at Woodstock, round midnight.
Thank you.
Still clapping.
They were a nice group of people, and it was a beautiful concert that evening. Everybody was very inspired because we weren't sure that we were going to get to do the concert, and people waited around as they will when they want to hear something or see a World Series or whatever. They just wait around however long it takes, and everybody was in pretty good shape that night.
Yeah. Around midnight, of course, Chick Corea and Lee Konitz. That's a real duo in the sense that it's not just running through a tune in an allotted amount of time. You really seem to have taken certain parts of the tune and examined each one for as long as you both felt necessary.
Literally destroyed and demolished the tune in places.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that.
But it was really thrilling for me because I'm very fond of Chick, and I welcomed any opportunity to be able to play in that setting. We played a few pieces. Anthony Braxton and Pat Metheny joined us, and Miroslav Vitos and Jack DeJohnette for a couple pieces, and it didn't work the same way. That contact was lost, and it was just, again, kind of just playing a tune and playing your choruses and getting off.
How do you view the direction Chick took in more recent years with Weather Report and with, I mean, not Weather Report, Return to Forever and the various bands? Have you ever had an inclination to get in on that wavelength?
Well, I would like to try it sometimes. I've never been invited to do that, and I've never made it happen myself, but I think a lot of the things he does are brilliant, and he just loves to do various kinds of things, so he's having a ball, you know.
Mm-hmm.
This next piece, Chick wrote for me after we spoke on a Friday out in California, and we met on Saturday afternoon, and he had written this little piece, which he calls Duende. So the theme of the album, which is called Touchstone, is a Spanish one, which is his wont. He has a special affinity for Spanish music, as we all know. And he had Paco de Lucia, the great Spanish flamenco guitarist, flew in from Spain to his studio to do some brilliant things. Paco is a great guitar player, wow. And he doesn't read, apparently, so Chick would... had sent him the music he had written, a cassette of it, months in advance, and he really did his homework. And so the album, as some people who have heard it know, is a combination of things with Paco and some Return to Forever group with Lenny White and Stanley Clark joining him. And it's a variety of pastiche of Spanish-type things. And this little piece... we did as a duo, which I would like to play first. And then Chick called me and said that he had written a string background for it. And I said, great, you know. And so the version that came out on the record is with the strings. I think both versions are very interesting.
So we'll hear it before and after?
Yeah.
Okay.
Duende, it's called. It means something about... the magic, something magical.
Yeah, I think it's the spirit or something.
Something like
a Spanish
that.
Word.
It's it's a beautiful word.
Untranslatable, yeah. Supposedly.
Thank you.
I've got to say, before you get a chance to say anything, I think that's absolutely beautiful.
Thank you. I love it too.
And that's available on a record, on Chick's new record.
Right. I was wondering how, after all the other music on the record, this would fit as a last track on one side, and it does, I think.
Yeah. It's a Chicory original, and he wrote the string.
Yes.
The string arrangements too. And as you mentioned, it was a string trio.
He wrote for a violin, cello, and bass, and they overdubbed. Took full advantage of our technological facilities.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing how it doesn't come off sounding overdubbed, and the intonation, everything matches so perfectly, and the arrangement and everything. It sounds like it was meant to be that way. Maybe he even had that in mind when you...
Chick has all of that in mind. For all of the facets of an operation, he is aware of each facet of it. He's standing over his engineer's shoulder, so to speak, watching it all.
Did you say before that this was recorded at his house?
At his studio.
He has a studio in his house.
It's a professional studio that other people record at also.
I see.
It's really quite nice. So, should we go on back about 14 years?
Yeah.
I did a show in Sauerbrücken, Germany, at the invitation of the radio in 68. And a composer named Hans Hammerschmidt wrote a piece either for me or a piece that he had already written for somebody else. I've never checked that out. But, some standard pieces. And I accepted this, as I do eagerly, as a chance to play with a large... This was actually the first time I ever played with a symphony-sized orchestra. And it was really quite a special thrill. It took me until the beginning of this year, I believe I got copies of this tape, 14 years later. I asked periodically, I'd think about it and write to somebody and say, is it possible, and never got a response. And finally, a friend of mine got them. So, I guess we could run these right straight through. The first piece, as you'll hear the announcer say, is Hammerschmidt's original piece, and then a piece standard at the time called Ode to Billy Joe.
Right.
This is my possible commercial hit, folks. you're the first ones to hear it in this country. And probably the last ones. And then the third piece is a piece written by Attila Zoller, named for his daughter. It's called Alicia's Lullaby.
Okay.
Lee Konitz, Burr Phillips und Stuart Martin mit dem großen Orchester des Saarländischen Rundfunks und vier Sequenzen für Altsaxophon und komponiert von Hans Hammerschmidt.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Lee.
Oh, excuse me. People wonder what you do when the records are playing.
Mm-hmm. Why don't you tell us those titles?
That last one was Alicia's Lullaby and Ode to Billy Joe Before Then and whatever the...
You're playing the baritone on that.
Well, it's a form of
a
it.
A form of the baritone.
It's called a con, made by con. It's called a multivider.
Multivider. Just for those saxophonists out there, you play a Selmer or no?
Yes, I do.
Have you always played one?
Most always, yes.
I see. I should identify, this is WKCR in New York, 89.9 on your dial. 8 minutes after one in the afternoon, this is Out to Lunch. My name is Loren Schoenberg.
Mine is Joe Selmer.
Hey, Joe.
Oh.
No, of course, that's Lee Konitz. Alto saxophonist is our guest, and he's kind of, I guess, doing a little gift to all you listeners out there, because Lee's bought 90 minutes worth of Lee Konitz material on tapes that you never would have heard before unless you happen to have been where these things were recorded. And we thank you again on behalf of the listeners and everyone else.
Hi, I'm enjoying it.
Yeah, I'm enjoying it too. We have some tickets to give away. I don't know if we can work this in with your next tune or anything, but Ahmad Jamal is doing a concert next Friday, the 19th of November at Brooklyn College, 8 o'clock. And Ahmad doesn't make too many concert appearances around New York, and I'm sure a lot of you would like the tickets. Now, I know that Lee wants a ticket. Well, I'll have to ask
two.
You
I like two tickets.
You like two tickets.
Yeah, I know the title of this one, so...
All right. We're jumping the gun here.
Yeah.
It's Gil Evans and Lee Konitz duo. We know that much.
Right. So this was from Green Street in the... February the January the 12th, 1980. It was the first time we ever did this together, and it's not quite the last time.
But it's such a big room.
Yeah, but it worked a little bit.
I was
there.
Music
got so slow. I think people were waiting to see if it would stop.
So, why don't you tell us what the rules will be here.
The rules are, if anyone can guess the melody of this tune, name the melody of this tune, then I guess you get those nice tickets.
You get those tickets.
I don't play it until the last chorus, so you have to listen.
Okay. The phone number here, 280-5223, area code 212. 280-5223, a pair of tickets to see the great Ahmad Jamal next Friday night, a week from tomorrow. You can name this tune. Lee Konitz and Gil Evans are playing. Good luck.
Vamp. You mean tell a joke or something?
Tell a joke while I turn the tape.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to mention that I'll be playing in... Paris on November 22nd, in case anyone's there. Come and say hello.
Okay, here we go.
Okay. Thank you.
I think you did that because you want the tickets.
You're darn right.
What's the answer? Because you stumped me, too.
It's Chopin's Prelude number 20.
Do you know what? Several thousand people just went, oh.
Yeah, several thousand people are out to lunch someplace.
That's right. And
the few people who called really pulled some unrelated tunes out there.
Summertime, Angel Eyes, Around Midnight, Goodbye, among others. But we thank you for calling and trying anyway.
Yeah, thank you, four people, for listening. go on with it?
Let's go on, and we'll do it.
The lopsided chronology.
Okay.
This one is a record tune. I wanted to play a tune from each of the three records that just came out that I made. Well, actually, with the Chick Corea, it'll be from four records that have most recently come out of mine. This one was the one with Art Pepper. I believe when I made it, it was supposed to be for Japanese release, but I saw it in Chicago, and I hear it's going to come around pretty soon. The title of the record is High Jingo, and this is my blues called A Minor Blues in F. Do you want to know anything about it?
Well, I don't want to know about the tune, because I know the tune, but... This is a morbid question, but it's one that just comes to mind naturally. Did you have any kind of feelings about that you're with Art, that this might be the last time you were going to see him? I mean, what was he ill when they made the record?
I had that feeling about Art for a long time. But this is the first, year before, I guess, was the first time that I spent any time with Art, and we met in Nice and rode in a car together and talked about reeds and things. And I've had an affinity for Art all these years, but we've never had an opportunity to play or to be together. Yeah. So I was pleased about that. And I, you know, when I have seen him, I know about some of his problems. I knew that he was really at this point enjoying some success finally for all his efforts.
Yeah.
And that it was amazing how he was able to endure the many travails that he had gone through and, and function as well. He was able to function. But John, he was very disturbed, and some of the music is a little, indicative of that.
John Dentz is on the drums. He's a East Coaster who now is doing very well out in...
Yeah, John is quite a good drummer, I think.
Yeah.
Bob Magnuson is a bass player, and a good piano player named Mike Lang.
Yeah, who's he?
Well, it's the first he was that was Art's rhythm section at the time. So, but Mike has done a lot of things in Hollywood, movie things, and his father is an active composer, I believe.
I see. All right, what tune are we going to hear?
Well, the A minor blues and F.
A minor blues and F.
A minor blues.
Does this tune have a? This reminds me like a Lester Young solo on Tickle Toe kind of thing. I mean, that's just. Off the cuff,
Dickie's Dream.
Right.
The pickup.
Okay.
That was my inspiration.
All right. Lee Konitz and Art Pepper. Okay. We'll do another ticket giveaway.
And, who's who?
The phone number 280-5223. You have to name me the big band that featured at one time Lee Konitz. And another time, I think earlier.
Oh, that's too easy.
Oh, yeah. Well, I want to show you there's people listening, so you better call up. 280-5223. What band did both Lee Konitz and Art Pepper play with in the early 1950s?
The light just lit.
Okay. We'll get this applause out of there in a minute. Just a lot of people in the studio today.
Thank you.
A minor blues in F. Lee Konitz.
A minor blues in F.
A minor blues in F.
Okay. I like it that way.
Recorded on the West Coast with Art Pepper, Mike Lang, Bob Magnuson, and John Dentz. And on an album called High Jingo, which I guess if it's already not in the import stores, should become more visible in New York in the near future.
Probably so. JRs, etc.
Yeah.
Was that a commercial?
No, not at all. We did have a winner, of course, before to the quiz question. Of course, the answer was Stan Kenton's band. And right now I've made the invitation privately. I'd like to make it over the airwaves to have you come back up for a few more shows, possibly do one of your earlier recordings and get your various comments on the different circumstances around them. And then do another show where we have musicians up and they bring the records that they listen to, a point which you already addressed before, that you hear that on the radio sometimes, so why do it again? But it gives a lot of insight about a musician to, you know, specifically what tunes of a particular artist did you listen to or pick up from.
Yeah.
And I'd like to ask you about, I don't know, did you ever listen to Frankie Trumbauer?
Yep. It's good, man.
Yeah. A whole bunch of topics to talk on, but of course today we're pretty much listening to a tape which our guest, Mr. Lee Konitz, brought up just for you listeners. A very special tape of never before heard performances, only heard when they were actually put out. And again, we very appreciative of your efforts to take the time and make this tape up and bring it up here. What do we got next?
This is from a new record that was, you gonna give anything away on this one?
You want to, or should we wait a while? You want to do it on
this
one?
Well, it will temper what I say about it, if you are.
Okay, yeah, we'll give away tickets if they can name the pianist.
Okay, so I'll tell you about it afterwards.
Okay, what's the tune?
It's Invitation.
Okay, and there's an invitation to you. This is for a pair of tickets to see the Ray Drummond Quartet at the Jazz Forum this weekend. Al Foster on the drums and John Hicks on the piano.
Someone knows the piano.
Someone knows who it is already.
Hey, Marcel, wait a minute.
Here we go with Lee Konitz duo. Tell me who the piano player is. Give me a ring at 280-5223 and you'll get him. Good luck. Thank you. Was a quiet audience, very rapt attention there.
Well, this was 5 hours after the concert had begun. We were the last act.
I see.
And so by then people had to catch their buses, and there was about half an audience, but they were quite good.
Where was this recorded?
In Berlin at a jazz thing there in November 80.
We had a lot of people calling up, guessing who it was, believe it or not.
Monk.
Monk and Liberace.
Yeah.
Now, the person that guessed Liberace, I guess, doesn't know that much about jazz, but...
Well, maybe Marcel sounds like Liberace to him.
He might for a second. So thank you to everyone that called up. Congratulations to our winner. And, of course, that was the great pianist, Marshall Solal. And Lee even gave you a little clue as to his name. But maybe it was a garbled reference. What's the history of your playing duos with pianos? Did you ever, when you would be on a gig way back with Lenny Tristano, play duos?
No, the only time I played duos with Lenny was at my lessons with him.
Lessons.
But at some point, I don't know exactly when that started, I realized that it was possible to do that, and it's something that I really enjoy doing.
And so you've made duo records with Hal Galper, Andrew Hill, Marshall Solal. Just piano duo records with any other piano, and Jimmy Rolls, those are duos on some of those titles.
Right. And this latest one with Michelle Petrucciani.
Michelle Petrucciani.
So far we haven't played a track, but we will play a track from there.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's it. I've made a few records with Martial now, and there's still one in the can, I believe. It's tied up in litigation right now.
I see. Where's that?
John Hammond has it.
Oh. What you got for us next?
Next one is from the session I did in 61 with Elvin Jones and Sonny Dallas. I found one tune that that wasn't on the record. It's Out of Nowhere. You want to just play that?
Sure. That's Sonny Dallas and Elvin Jones.
Right.
And a classic record. I'm sure most of you have it or have heard it. It's called Motion. Was that record? Was that for Norman Granz or Creed Taylor?
Creed Taylor was the was in the booth.
I see.
I think he had sold the company.
I think the record is still in print.
It comes out on Japanese prints. I think this year.
Was this a trio you were working with at the time, or how did Elvin Jones come into the picture through Coltrane's group? You had heard him with Coltrane, or?
Well, I actually I had asked Max to do it, and he couldn't, and he suggested Elvin. And Elvin was working with Coltrane the night before. This was a 9 o'clock date.
9 a.m.?
9 a.m.
Oh,
geez. And he came in, and the first tune was a take.
Had you heard the... He had made some trio records with saxophone before with Sonny Rollins and Wilbur Ware.
Oh, yeah.
Had you heard those at all?
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, after the fact, actually. I just got a copy of it recently, actually. I had heard it before, but I didn't own it.
Had you ever had the chance to, just as long as we're rambling a little bit, to play with Sonny Rollins at all on the same, stand?
Well, I sat in with Sonny at the Village Vanguard one evening when Attila Zola was playing with him briefly.
Oh, I see.
And Sonny, in this very witty way, told me in the kitchen, said, "Don't play too long. This is my gig." So, all right. But I enjoyed it, and I wish I could play more extensively with Sonny.
Yeah.
One time in San Francisco, when I was living near there, I went into the club he was working at during a matinee. Paul Blay was playing with him at the time, and Sonny hadn't arrived yet, so Paul asked me to sit in, and apparently Sonny arrived while I was playing, and when he when he got up to play, I never heard anything like it. He was really extra special that afternoon. He went right out there and stayed there. I'm sure Paul had a lot to do to prod him out there, you know. But it was really something.
Yeah. All right, Lee Konitz, our guest on Out to Lunch. Outtake from an album called Motion, Out of Nowhere. Sonny Dallas on the bass, Elvin Jones drums. Thank you. out of nowhere. Sonny Dallas, Elvin Jones, and our guest, Lee Konitz.
I think Elvin was a great brush player. It's interesting, especially considering that he was working the night before with John Coltrane and two basses at that time, and, you know, really playing some different kind of music. And he was up for anything that what there was to do.
Yeah, well, it's very telling. He was recommended, as you said, to the date by Max Roach. So, you know, Max had that great ability, too, I guess, to fit in a variety of contexts.
Sure.
Because I've always been amazed at the those Nonet records that you're on with Miles Davis, how he adapted to each score, you know, the way on the sessions that Max is on. You know, the way he really adapts himself and plays the chart. He's not just another drummer sitting back there keeping time. He's, you know, a thorough musician.
The next piece is, I was only able to do one date with Elvin because everybody was going out of town or whatever, regrettably, because it felt good and it was the first time that the three of us had ever played together and I wanted to do another date. But I did another date with Sonny Dallas and Nick Stabulus, and none of that was ever released, and I recently heard some of it, and I liked it. This is one tune from that group of tunes, so it's I Remember You. Mm-hmm.
Lee Konitz Trio from an unreleased album. I guess it never even got to be an album, from some unreleased tapes. Was that done the same year, 1961?
Yeah.
I see.
After the one with Alvin.
You own the tapes, or the Cree Taylor owned them? I mean, so you couldn't put them out.
No, they're owned by, now PolyGram has a whole bunch of tapes. They're talking now about releasing one that I did with Bill Evans and Warren Marsh, Paul Modian and Jimmy Garrison from the old Half Note.
Wow.
So they might get around to these sometime too.
Yeah. The jazz world was very, very happy when those records came out. I'm speaking for the jazz world, I guess. Those records recorded at the Sing Song Room or the Confucius Restaurant or whatever, the things with Lenny and...
Yeah.
Lenny Tristano, Gene Ramey, and Arthur Taylor. Had you known that they existed?
I hadn't given it a thought. I knew that they had come into the club to record an evening or so, and they released five tunes, I believe, on Tristano's record years ago, and that was it. 26 years later, they called me and said they had 13 more tunes and sent me a tape, and I said, fine, yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I believe some of the items were recorded in stereo, and they weren't put out in stereo in those days.
Right.
But I heard some of them yesterday, and they're real fine stereo recordings. We're heading up to 2 p.m. It's 2 minutes before 2:58. Loren Schoenberg with you on Out to Lunch, our guest, Lee Konitz. And for all you musicians and Lee Konitz fans out there, you're probably wondering, why aren't I asking him a whole bunch of interesting questions? Well, I have a whole bunch of interesting questions, but we're going to save that for another show and another situation where we can really get into depth about his career and his influences. Pretty much today, at Lee's behest, we're just sharing some very great moments in music Lee's brought up from his private collection. And I'd like to take this opportunity to let the listeners in on a couple of other things we do on KCR. We do live broadcasts every week, one from the Blue Note, 1 a.m. every Saturday morning. This week it'll be Monty Alexander in a very special broadcast. We also do one from the West End. And here's a little announcement I made up several months ago about the West End broadcasts.
Yeah, it seems as though the greatest jazz never really took place in the record studio, but live on the bandstand. And sometimes those bandstand performances were lucky enough to be broadcast. It was actually quite a common thing back in the 30s and 40s, even in the 50s, but now it's a rarity. But where else on WKCR are you going to find these live bandstand performances? Well, every Friday night, 9 p.m. The great swing musicians, many of whom participated in the classic recordings of the 30s and 40s, when broadcasting live from the West End Bandstand over WKCR, 9 p.m. till 9:30 every Friday. Hope you'll be our guest for some more classic moments in jazz with Live from the West End, Fridays, 9 p.m.
Sweet, need heart. Tomorrow is another day. Don't break my heart. Oh, honey, please don't be that way.
Jazz Profiles this Sunday celebrates that icon of jazz singing, Ella Fitzgerald. Tune in as we trace her amazing career from her days as a teenage vocal star with Chick Webb in the 1930s to her most recent recordings. That's this Sunday at 3 p.m. for a 5.5-hour survey of the music of Ella Fitzgerald. Where else but on WKCR-FM in New York.
Artists will assemble for 8 exciting hours of great music. Artists will include the likes of Melba Liston, J.R. Mitchell, Odine Pope, Arthur Taylor, Charlie Persip, and many more. So don't miss this musical extravaganza that looks to be a day not soon forgotten. The concert will take place at Woolman Auditorium at Columbia University at 115th Street and Broadway. Tickets are $10 and available at the door. So plan to join Master of Ceremonies Eddie Curtis this Sunday from 3 till 11 p.m. in memory of Ray Draper. For further information, you can call us here at WKCR-FM 280-5223. Hope you can be there.
Yeah, the Ray Draper Tribute, Sunday, November 14th, 3 p.m. here at Woolman Auditorium, Columbia University. This is Out to Lunch, 4 minutes after 2. Loren Schoenberg with you, and our guest, Mr. Lee Konitz.
I guess we could also call this Alto Lunch.
Alto Yuck, Lunch.
Just thought of that. So this next and last piece from the tape is from 80 with the Danish...
1980.
Yeah, well, it's not 1880.
Well.
Danish Radio Orchestra. I was invited to play there. They have a fine orchestra with Niels Henning, the bass player, and a lot of good musicians. Idris Suleiman was in that band. I played actually half an hour of duos with Niels Henning. I didn't bring any of that this time. And then a few pieces with the big band. And this first one is my choruses that I wrote out on It's You or No One, and the line in front that Niels and I play. And Niels is such a beautiful musician and guy. This is a bunch of eighth notes in this line, and we rehearsed, you know, the afternoon before the concert, and he was in the corner with me by himself running over this line. He really wanted to play it, and there's a couple little things here and there that he didn't quite make, but he did an amazing job. Wow. And then that segues right into Stella by Starlight, the arrangement by Bill Holman.
Okay.
Og så er det igen Lee Konitz' tur. Vi skal have 2 numre i denne omgang. Det første er en, han selv har lavet og arrangeret, og det bygger på en kendt standardmelodi. Man kan gætte med på, hvad det er for en. Lee Konitz har kaldt sin for It's You. Og bagefter skal vi have Bill Holmans arrangement af Stella by Starlight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, man. That's beautiful.
I like those Jewish notes at the end there.
Yes.
Did you see that program with Yitzhak Perlman? And the man asked him with the Andre Previn and those people.
Mm-hmm.
They said, how'd you like, you know, playing this jazz?
This jazz, jazz music. And
he said, I enjoy it very much, but I'm just hoping it didn't sound too Jewish. I love that line.
Yeah. When you go over and do a guest shot like that with a Dutch radio band, is it for concerts? Is it for a media presentation? Is it specifically for a radio show?
Yeah, they have series.
And they have a guest jazz
this
artist?
This is the Danish orchestra. There Danish. Is a Dutch one, too. I'm going to see them on November the 29th. It's the same idea. When a guest is in Europe, they say, give us a call and come by if you're free and do a few tunes with the band. And they broadcast from something equivalent to the Village Vanguard, a little club.
Oh, it's a club.
In Copenhagen, it was at the Montmartre. And in Holland, it's in a place near Hilversum, where they have most of the radio facilities. And it's a little funky roadhouse club, and it's a tradition. Every Monday night, someone's going to be jumping there. You know, it's great. And I just don't have that in here, as you've heard ad nauseum by now, I'm sure. But there's no place to do that in America, and it's just incredible by now to me.
And, of course, that's a state affair over there. I mean, it's
state is involved to some extent.
They pay they foot the bills, don't they?
Well, to some extent,
radio,
I don't know exactly how.
Maybe the radio, the radios do, but the radio is probably owned by the state.
Some way.
The point I was going to make was that it's the artists are in a way subsidized by the state. And you're right; that's an oft-talked about subject, but one that always bears repeating. Well, we came to the end of the tape that Lee brought with him. That you bought here. So we're going to turn to a tape we have at the station. Lee's been very kind in his time for WKCR as long ago as 75. You came up and did a trio session, I know, with Dave Shapiro and...
I heard that recently. That sounded pretty nice.
Yeah. And you also were part of our KCR benefit. And I was going to pull a trick on the listeners and do a ticket giveaway and say, name the tenor player on this next cup, but I've decided not to. It's me, of course, and I know that my way of playing is so well known, it just wouldn't be a chance for anyone to get through.
Yeah, right, I know what you mean.
The phone lines would be backed up. But Lee did do a tune with my band, and it was a lot of fun. In fact, on the tape, I'm talking for about 10 minutes about what a thrill it was, and it was. And we're going to play that tape now, so this is... I can introduce this one, Lee Konitz and yours truly, and the rhythm section with Hal Gaylor, Mel Lewis, and Dick Katz at the Jazz Forum doing Pound Cake, Blues and G, and then we go into arrangement of Body and Soul. Who's the Body and Soul?
Tommy Newsom, Doc Severinsen's left-hand man.
Right.
Nice arrangement, I think.
Yeah, it's a great arrangement. And Lee Konitz with Loren Schoenberg's big band at the Jazz Forum. August 24th, 1982. Thank you.
happy that I could dance. I'm just gonna bring in.
Yes, indeedy. Lee Konitz at the Jazz Forum with my band. That was a lot of fun that night, and it's nice to hear the tape again. Uh-huh. Sound beautiful on it.
Thanks.
Body and Soul and Pound Cake. Yes. A little after 2:30. What time you got? 2:30.
A little after 2:30
here.
3 or so.
Time to see the Chinese dentist. Talk about old jokes. We got something now from your duo album with Marcel.
No, this is with Misa. Michelle Petrucciani. I wanted to play and say a word about this. This was done in Paris in May of this year, as I said, and the man who owns this company, Owl Records, OWL, Jean-Jacques Pousseau, was very concerned. He's handling, in a way, Michelle's career, and he had recorded Michelle in a solo album and a trio album previous to this. And he, when he asked me to do it, he indicated to me that he really wanted to do it right, and he really did, and I really have to commend him and just tell you briefly what he did to make it right. First of all, Michelle is 19 years old, and he's a very talented piano player. As you can see from the picture, Michelle is a very little guy, and he has been living in Toulon, France. His family is very musical. He has a bone disease, and he's a very small person. He has regular size hands and a gigantic spirit. And so the first thing that Jean-Jacques did right was to rent the showroom of the Bösendorfer house in Paris. And little Michelle is sitting at a 9-foot Bösendorfer, not in that picture, that was done someplace else. Mm-hmm. But if you can get this picture in this beautiful place. Jean-Jacques got a classical engineer who apparently had never recorded jazz before, and I think he gets just a very special sound from those two instruments. And then, it was a good feeling at the date, and then the next day we went to a very famous photographer's home, a man named Boubé, and he took that lovely picture of us standing and sitting. At one point, I thought it was interesting. This is a lover man in 3/4, and I was standing about 4 feet or so away from Michelle, who had had his glasses broken a week or so before. And as we were playing, after about 5 minutes or so, I started to kind of indicate, you know, with the various signals that we'd be taking it out, you know. And so he went into the next chorus, and then I tried this for 10 more minutes, and finally we got to the end of the piece, and it felt nice, so I just kept playing along with it. And we finished, and I looked at Michelle and said, "What happened, man? That was nice, but I was trying to, you know, to take it out before I gave you some signals." He said, "I can't see you, man. I didn't have my glasses on." But it turned out that we did 2 15-minute pieces. One, I think, is almost 16 minutes around midnight, and a few other tunes. We each play a solo and a couple other standards. But I like this track particularly well, and I hope everybody else does. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
You're going to tell me you didn't have any music.
That's all written in the sky.
Man. And duo, Lee Konitz and Michelle Petrucciani.
Yeah, pretty close. Petrucciani.
Petrucciani. And on the album's called Toot, T-O-O-T, Sweet, S-W-E-E-T, on the Owl label. And what can one say? It's a beautiful version. That story makes it all the more interesting about how you hadn't intended it to be such a extended version. And you two really seemed to work hand in glove. Had you played together quite a bit by the time you made the record?
No, we had hardly played together, actually.
Oh.
So it was just that we had a good affinity together. A few times we spent time together, and it seemed like it was going to happen that way, and it did.
Yeah. I hope we have the chance to see Michelle here in the States again soon. You mentioned you're going to be seeing him over in Europe.
Yes. Well, he was supposed to move to Carmel, Big Sur. He's recently married a young lady who lives in Big Sur, and he's been playing with Charles Lloyd. And Charles lives out there, so I think he's going to move there in December.
We'll see. Well, we've got one more little gift for our listeners. This is another title done down to Jazz Forum August 24th, when Lee was the guest with my band for the KCR benefit. Let's get to it right now, and then we'll say our goodbyes. This is Cherokee, arranged by Bill Holman, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. Lee Konitz.
Do you need to say anything about the start on this, the way it starts?
Oh, I forgot. It starts with an unaccompanied alto saxophone, and obviously the people that were taping it for the station were changing reels. I guess I didn't give them enough time to change it. So it's missing, I think, less than 16 bars. So we're coming in somewhere in the first chorus.
Good.
Okay.
Let them roll, baby. Let them roll. Thank you.
indeedy. Lee Konitz in Cherokee, August 24th, 1982. Well, we're heading home, heading down the home stretch. Just got a couple of minutes left. And, as our theme song sneaks in the background here.
I thought they turned the radiator on. Bang.
Lee, I'd like to thank you very much for coming up and sharing the music with us.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Anytime. And can I put you on the spot and make you accept another invitation?
Definitely.
Okay. When you come back from Europe, I'll have you up for, as I mentioned, I'd like to do a show in which you'd bring your records, your own records you'd like to talk about.
Okay.
Or maybe things of more vintage. And then another show with the records you like to listen to. We can get more of an insight. We certainly did have a lot of insight into your music since you brought all that rare material up with you. So, this is Out to Lunch. Loren Schoenberg with you. And our guest again, Mr. Lee Konitz. We're going to sign off. Stay tuned for Afternoon Music with Stefan Zucker. Take care. Hope you enjoyed the show. We'll be at the station for a couple of minutes. 280-5223. Bye-bye.